Let me repeat, as always at the AA, we are absolutely delighted to welcome into lectures anyone who has an interest in architecture. And for those of you who kind of fall under that category, please feel absolutely at home here. Thank you very much.
Well, we're, sorry, just a second, technology again. Actually, I just looked at my picture on the poster and I should be lecturing like this. So today is the second of some sort of post holes into architectural discourse in the early period of the second half of the century. We're going to move today away from the formation and development of the movement called Brutalism to the formation and development of the movement called Townscape, and also from Townscape, the resistance against Townscape by those architects who, while interested in both saving the landscape and saving the British patrimony, are turning towards a kind of functional tradition or vernacular. So we have a double vision of how modernity can be continued, but the different strains of intellectual crisis around modernity have different responses. For the generation that graduated from architecture schools in the decade following World War II, was a generation in search of new principles for architecture itself. In the shadow of the modern masters, two of them you see there, critical of the social and urban effects of international style modernism, yet reluctant to abandon a commitment to modern architecture. They looked in different ways for continuity through more or less radical revision. When Ernesto Rogers, for example, opened the relaunch of the formerly Mussolini-dominated magazine Casa Bella after the war with the added title Continuità, Casa Bella Continuità. He was searching for continuity. When Tafuri starts writing, the first words he writes in his first monograph are, "The question remains continuity or crisis, crisi o continuità." Ernesto Rogers was the most explicit with continuity, and in an Italy emerging from fascism, necessarily so, as to the values of continuity opposed to another avant-garde crisis of form, but a continuity that includes the seeds of change. In Britain, the crisis was less political, with Labour winning the first post-war election, but if continuity was sought, it was with the sense of the need for a tougher, a more accentuated response to what is thought of the soft modernism of Sweden or the polished corporate styles emerging from the USA. London, after the end of hostilities in 1945, was, to say the least, depressing. And the attempts of the government to jolly things up by launching the Festival of Britain in 1951 rang false to many of the architects of this new generation: the Smithsons, Stirling, Bannum, Wilson. The evocation of an industrially progressive nation settled comfortably at home with new Swedish design products, and that home settled into a rural Arcadia. Promoted by the exhibits, the contrast between the soft modernism of the festival hall and the technological possibilities inherent in the otherwise useless Skylon, the design of which Jim Stirling's future partner James Gowan had worked with Powell and Moyer, together with the increasing fashion for Swedish modern in both design and urban planning, was troubling to those who returned from a brutal war and, inspired by the apparent rigor of the modern pioneers, Corbusier and Mies, were also inclined to use of materials that was, so to speak, materialistic, whether or not in the political sense. Modernism, arriving late in England and seen as importive, not only figuratively, but literally, with the arrival of the European exiles, Lubeckan, Goldfinger, Fry, then Gropius and Pevsner, was by 1945 extremely diverse and absent the theoretical or moral grounds of the first generation. Indeed, J.M. Richards, writing under the title The Next Step, and admitting that it is too soon to label and classify, proceeded to do that precisely. He classified no less than 11 varieties of modern architecture current in Britain. He listed the pioneers, from Le Corbusier to Maillard, the international style, as exemplified by the Peckham Health Center, routine functionalism in 1949 project for flats at Poplar, formalist in the works of Tate, neoclassical, as revived by Piacentini in Rome, the mechanistic approach of designers like Fuller, the machine aesthetic of Mies and Johnson, and the schools of the Hertfordshire County Architects Department, a diagrammatic modern as championed by Pietro Bellucci, a post-Cubist style of Bachmer, the regional organic of Frank Lloyd Wright and Breuer, but also of Basil Spence as they search for a new regionalism, and we'll talk about that a little bit later, and finally what Richards calls the empirical organic from Aalto and the Swedish movement to Shepherd and Partners that sought, quote, inspiration in the particular site, structure, and materials rather than the general. By such and similar means, concluded Richards somewhat optimistically, the process begins of introducing a new emotional content into the solid framework of the contemporary idiom. This was, of course, the reaction of architects, but it was also the reaction of cultural figures, George Orwell's 1984, which of course was 1948, was precisely an image of England as he saw it then. The Angry Young Men, Kingsley Amis, John Osborne, Alan Citato, and you'll remember that I mentioned yesterday that Banham actually called Jim Sterling Lucky Jim. John Brain and a movie. If you've seen it, it's incredible to remember, and if you haven't seen it, see it. And of course, the music, the soft music of Buddy Holly, you remember? And Mick Jagger in Gimme Shelter. Resistance to what was seen as the second-hand, eclectic, pseudo-modernism took many architectural forms. First, there was the group within the London County Council that, taking the example of the Unité at Marseille, attempted to construct a community as well as housing in high density. Cullen and June Wilson's housing at Roehampton was an example. Then there were those for whom Mies van der Rohe, as we found with the Stirlings in early Hans Stanton, in his uncompromising allegiance to steel construction and its aesthetic qualities, was an example of a continuing modernist practice, the Smithson's project for Hans Stanton. In this search, the younger generation of architects were actually supported by the surprising Catholicity of the Architectural Review. This is the 1945 edition of the Architectural Review. Despite the individual sensibilities of Hugh de Croning Hastings, Gordon Collins, Eric de Marlais, and Nicholas Pevsner, the journal hosted debates in the next 10 to 15 years over questions as diverse as those proposed by Colin Rowe in his Palladianizing of Le Corbusier, 1947, The Mathematics of the Ideal Villa, and the modern movement in general, his Mannerism of Modern Architecture in 1950. They hosted Eric de Marais' photographic attempt to revitalize the canon in his three-part survey of Scandinavian, British, American, and Russian ideas in 49, Banham's New Brutalism in 55, and Gordon Cullen's outrage over the townscape environment supported by de Croning Hastings' own crusade for a new picturesque. Indeed, the Architectural Review seemed open to all comers at the same time as proposing itself a fairly consistent editorial position against what Pevsner called the new historicism and for de Cronin's campaign for a comprehensive adoption of townscape. On its signature blue, brown, and sometimes yellow paper inserts, contrary visions of what might be a principal post-war architecture were posted and refuted, often by the editors themselves. Introducing the January 1947 issue of the Architectural Review, the editors wrote, "Let it therefore be boldly stated that the Architectural Review has a call, a call of quite a low-class evangelical kind. It's an interesting statement, that, from De Cronin Hastings. Underneath its more obvious airs, running through them and linking them together, is another less tangible one, which may be to describe by the words visual re-education. And I think that one of the very interesting splits in the architectural scene in the 1940s was the split between those who saw architecture as a visual art linked to urbanism as a visual experience, and those who saw architecture as a material constructive art. And there we, of course, have brutalism. And I noted yesterday the strange dichotomy in Rainer Bannon's essay on brutalism, where he gave both the principles of materiality and the principles of visual accessibility and visual unity to brutalist architecture. And we'll be talking about this in a bit. So J.M. Richards, Nicholas Pevsner, Osbert Lanchester, and Hugh de Cronin Hastings celebrated in 1947 the second half of the century, the second half of the Review's publication, with this bold statement of policy. The modern movement in architecture, they said, was now finally accepted as being made of very stern stuff indeed, thus freeing the Review to widen its scope, side by side with the obligation to provide a third program for architecture. The editors affirmed was the equally strong mission to educate the public in the art of architecture, to act in the cause of visual culture. What it meant was made more clear by a reference to that great visual educator, Uvedel Price, the 18th century picturesque landscape gardener, a model for Hugh de Cronin Hastings for the understanding of the visual experience bound to, quote, the pursuit of visual life presented in Landscape and Townscape, the first use of this word in the Architectural Review. And well, actually, we'll see it's not quite the first use, but the first use in a major editorial. The first half century, they wrote, had seen the drama of the modern movement, and it was summarized in two acts as a drama by Pevsner in one of his earliest visual essays for the Architectural Review. There we have the second half century, and the first half century literally seen as the first half century with the modern movement emerging and the various icons of the modern movement photographically displayed all the way through, with critical commentary by Pevsner to what's going to happen in the second half of the century. Act one, said Pevsner, where Ruskin, Morris, and the arts and crafts movements have prepared the ground, have been followed by Act two, which traced the natural development of new visual symbols and the acceptance of new building techniques. But a third act was now needed in order to bring true visual principles to the technological expressionism. This act, Pevsner wrote, would bring back that most English of English traditions, the picturesque, studied now not in terms only in terms of landscape design, but, quote, in relationship to the new problems of the urban landscape, unquote. This act would reinstate the main plot to recapture the scope and richness discarded by the modern revolution and to work for a rehumanization, the building up of tradition, new richness and differentiation of character, the pursuit of differences rather than sameness, the reemergence of monumentality, the cultivation of idiosyncrasy, the development of those regional dissimilarities that people have always taken pride in, unquote. This is almost a manifesto for what later in the 70s and 80s became, of course, postmodernism. Architecture, he concluded, this is Pevsner, must find a way of humanizing itself as regards expression without in any way abandoning the principles on which the revolution was founded. Modern architecture was too dominated by planning, producing a too coordinated scene, but had not yet acquired a visual three-dimensional status, nor had the new scale that the landscape element has introduced into architecture been fully assimilated. Incorporation of the visual properties of architecture would allow for a continuity of tradition using historic precedent constructively and not as an escape. In this assertion of principle were bound up all the complex strands that were to preoccupy the Review over the next 30 years: the dedication to visual experience, the identification of such experience with the themes long established in the English picturesque tradition of the 18th century, the demand to make these themes both pertinent and graphically visible to a public at large, and the seeds of what Pevsner himself would observe some 14 years later, and not without some dismay, the return to historicism in what he called the postmodern movement of architecture in 1960 and 61. The principles outlined in the second half century, however, and if we look back before 47 in the review, have been developed by Huidekronen Hastings much earlier, writing as the editor 3 years before under the title Exterior Furnishing, or Shararwagi, the Art of Making Urban Landscape. Here, Hastings harked back to the time of Ebenezer Howard and Raymond Unwin and the late 19th century effort to allow, this is beautiful, Billy Brown, the little man, and Bill Brown, the working man, to live a decent life in decent surroundings. An effort tied to the image of the Garden City, whence derived the popularity of the quote-unquote semi-Tudor style, a style that still maintains suburban traction some 50 years later. Andrew Ballantyne, by the way, has recently published a wonderful history of the semi-Tudor and half-Tudor in suburban England. I think he's somewhat embarrassed by the book, but the book itself is wonderful. Hastings noted that England was no longer looked to as the head of international inspiration in architecture as it had been in the time of the arts and crafts movement. Planners had failed to provide an alternative picture comparable in realism, vividness, or simplicity, while technological or transportation-based models of the culture could not hold the Browns, who, quote, want a picture of the kind of world the physical planner will make. And up to date, he has been given nothing between Port Sunlight and the Mars Group. There was, Hastings argued, a serious need for a picture, literally a picture, he writes, that would reconcile visually in the mind's eye what appear to be irreconcilable elements in any town plan, quaint bits, new bits, monuments, traffics, tall buildings, short buildings, flat blocks, individual cottages, etc. Thus he advanced the solution picturesque theory, and he gave a whole series of photographic illustrations of what he understood to be this kind of picturesque conjuncture of the elements that otherwise would be too unified in the international style. Picturesque theory, as it evolved in England in the 18th century and was internationalized in the early 19th. What we really need to do now, he suggested, was to resurrect the true theory of the picturesque and apply a point of view already existing to a field in which it has not been consciously applied before, the city. He admitted this would demand a revolution in taste and therefore supplied a photo essay as a means of developing the elements of this revived theory. Photographs illustrate the idea of the street picturesque, the liveliness of the picturesque street whose chimneys, odd roof angles, producing protruding boughs, trees and shrubs, chiaroscuro, some distant eye catcher closing the vista, constitute a genuine piece of urban landscape. The old and the new, a contrast of complementarities. The success and failure of accident as opposed to the visual laissez-faire which produced a mining camp, not an urban landscape. In a masterstroke of prospective nostalgia, Hastings concluded by taking as his model for such theory that of Uberdale Price and Payne Knight, as described in Christopher Hush's recent book, The Picturesque. The art of landscape picturesque was, he claimed, identical to what the Chinese called shararwagi, or irregular gardening. Landscape should be observed with the painter's eye, Claude Lorraine, Salvatore Rosa, John Piper, John Nash, Edward Borden, Edward Vavilius, Christopher Wood, Kenneth Rowntree, painters of urban scenery against those who see the New Jerusalem as all open space and concrete. This series of dialectical photographs would lead, Hastings hoped, to a visual policy for an urban landscape, one that was as natural to the English temperament. He concluded, any time he so desires, the modern town planner is free to pick up picturesque theory at the point before its corruption by the Gothic revival, pick up the theory, rediscover its profits, apply the principles, and hey presto, townscape. Perhaps the most dramatic of these early appeals to the picturesque and visual, there's some more of his essays, have been published in 1941 following the 74 days of the London Blitz and entitled The Architecture of Destruction. An introduction by the artist John Piper sketched the impression of London's ruins, roads blocked, warehouses still burning. The article was illustrated by photographs of the bombed out shells of churches and offices taken the morning after the air raid, a sea of smoking rubble. These terrifying images were, however, accompanied by a surprising commentary. The, quote, transparent shell of a corner building exhibits drama. Paternoster Square and Ave Maria Lane are seen as, quote, examples of the surprising proportions of air raid scenery, unquote. The north of St. Paul's has been transformed into a grotto. Stone calcinated by fire has, quote, a peculiar quality, the striking motifs of windowless arcades. The article ended by enthusiastically noting, quote, the surprising poetry of destruction, the oddity of newly bombed interiors, and the almost gaiety. Where we go? I think this is it. The almost gaiety, like a scene in a French film, of a garden in the next morning's sunshine. These were ruins looked at with an artist's eye, as architecture in their own right, exhibiting an intensive, evocative atmosphere to be admired, frankly, for their own beauty. This was the picturesque, allied, of course, with the terrible sublime, and pressed into the service of visual re-education with a vengeance. These articles were to anticipate many devoted to the, on one hand, to the theory of the picturesque, and on the other, to Townscape. Hastings, under the pseudonym Ivor de Wolfe, wrote Townscape, basing his theory on Ubedel's Price, not surprisingly, Essay on the Picturesque. Prefacing a pictorial essay by the illustrator Gordon Cullen entitled A Townscape Casebook, The Beginnings of the Townscape as Drawn in 1947. The beginnings of Cullen's powerful role as a popular illustrator of the principles of Townscape. Pevsner wrote on the picturesque, countering Basil Taylor's assertion that it represented, excuse me, an imperfect vision, and claiming that the modern movement itself had its roots in the aesthetic, and demonstrating his thesis by reference to Le Corbusier's informal grouping of houses at Stuttgart. Hastings' article on Townscape was unambiguous. The movement, he said, that used to be called functionalism has developed an inner schism in which one party, figurehead Le Corbusier, has moved towards the rational or classic or crystalline solution, the other, figurehead Frank Lloyd Wright, towards the romantic or, as he would say, organic. There is a third movement so far not identified by the critics, might be called English or radical, since it belongs to neither of the above categories, neither American or French. The war cry of the irregular. This needs a casebook, like the casebook of common law. An aesthetic theory had now been presented with the claim that it was as English as the common law of the country. That such a theory is implicitly counter, if not postmodern, and certainly anti-European, was demonstrated by the furious response of Alan Cahoon to Pevsner's claim that Le Corbusier himself was influenced by the picturesque. Cahoon retorted that Pevsner's Le Corbusier was an entirely visual fabrication and owed nothing to the internal ideational content of the architecture. But Cahoon was himself working out of the image of Le Corbusier fashioned by Colin Rowe, that of a modernist manipulating the geometries of Palladian plans and the imbricated techniques of Mannerist facades within the vocabulary of purist abstraction. And Rowe, as has since become evident, was like his contemporary in art history Clement Greenberg, himself making up the constituents of what he called a modernism that was in its unifying formal characteristics far from the heterogeneous work of the avant-garde in the 20s and 30s. And we shall see him moving in that invention towards, and more closely towards, Townscape than even he would have suggested. In essence, as Frederick Jameson has noted, the modernism of the 1950s was an ideology invented specifically to justify a specific concept, flatness for Greenberg, mannerism for Rowe, by means of a reverse reading of history. This post-modern movement ideology, in its turn, was to aspire a second reverse reading, that of postmodernism. While this essential characteristic of post-World War theory was not immediately evident at the time, too much was invested in the precarious victory of modern architecture to deny its continuities with the new theoretical openings today. Today, the apparently and explicitly oppositional nature of Rowe and Curtis' collage city to townscape seems less abrupt. Indeed, as John MacArthur has recently demonstrated, the similarities between a visual theory of urban composition from ground level, Cullen's townscape, and a visual theory based on aerial photography and figure ground plans, Rowe's collage city, the similarities are more striking than their differences. In this context, it's entirely logical to find Robert Venturi's first article published under the rubric Townscape in May 1953, way before Complexity and Contradiction, in the May 1953 issue of Architectural Review. Entitled The Campidoglio, a Case Study, Venturi's thesis was entirely visual and concerned with the way in which the character of Michelangelo's formalizing of the Campidoglio had been injured by the ignorance of the principles that, quote, the architect had a responsibility towards the landscape which he can subtly enhance or impair, for we see, wrote Venturi, in perceptual holes, and the introduction of any new building will change the character of all the other elements in a scene. Venturi, in a sequence of figure ground plans and sections, demonstrated the point. Michelangelo had modified the piazza so that the original senatorial palace was given emphasis by the contrasting elements of the flanking buildings, color, texture, and the neutral, even rhythm of their columned facades. The intrusion of a huge monumental structure of the monument Vittorio Emanuele, what Venturi called a shiny monster, had destroyed the setting with its intricate, small-scale neighborhoods. And thus the effect of the ascent to the Campidoglio itself, ending in the powerfully visually controlled piazza, as well as the view from the top, which formerly offered views tantalizing, interrupted with rich, unaffected architectural foregrounds, was destroyed. A wrecking crew, he concluded, could hardly have damaged it more. The transition from the visual theory of townscape to that of postmodernism was thus affected by this move, from the urban context to the single building, aided by the sense in the early 1950s that architecture itself has been lost among the different ways it had sought to justify its social and technological role. When in 1966, Venturi finally published the work that he had begun in 1954 in Rome, the shift was complete. Under the guise of returning to an original autonomy for architecture, Venturi cataloged the ways in which contemporary architecture might regain some of the richness seemingly lost through modernist abstraction and all the techniques employed by Hastings, Pevsner, and Cullen to revive the visual complexity and contrast of the urban scene were now used to restore visual complexity to the single building. I think that shift is very, very significant, the shift from townscape to a townscape and visual understanding of the complexity of the building and the individual building itself. And I think at that point, Venturi actually lost a sense of the urban and gained a sense of the internal townscapes, if you like, of the buildingscape. And there, a little bit later, in 1975-76, Collage City, with the top-down version of the mental construction of the city, the medieval city on the left and the modern rational city on the right. And of course, the culmination of the Cullen townscape, Cullen and Hastings townscape revolution in the special issue of Architectural Review entitled Outrage. But there was another and slightly different version of visual architecture emerging on the side of the younger generation that we spoke of yesterday. And it was a generation seriously concerned, as was the general population of thinking Britain in the late 1940s. Most of the heritage foundations, most of the historic building foundations were all constructed by government fiat during the war itself, after the Blitz. There's a very strong. Nicholas Bullock has pointed this out in his extraordinary history of the first 10 years after the post-war, where all the heritage societies emerged to save rural Britain, to save vernacular, and to save the patrimony. The English house, in general considered a rural house, whether an aristocratic mansion or a cottage, had attracted a good deal of scholarly and nostalgic journalist attention in the late 1930s, increasing in intensity after the war. For it was widely recognized that as a disappearing species, the efforts of the non-government organization of the National Trust, under the benign administrations of James Lees Milne, had succeeded in saving a large number of small and great estates from destruction. But small towns and villages were undergoing rapid transformations, both in population and economic development. Villages were depopulated, suburbs were encroaching on formerly rural land, the landscape was being littered with the detritus of technological civilization, hereby Outrage, a special issue of the Architectural Review entitled Outrage of 1955, illustrated by dramatic photographs and drawings by Cullen of the deteriorated environment of what he called subtopia, underlined this concern. As Sidney Jones wrote in his comprehensive survey of village architecture, English village houses, published in the late 30s, quote, old houses and cottages in the villages are diminishing rapidly. A heritage of unique value is in danger of being destroyed. The middle class also was discovering the possibilities of second homes in the country, and a series of books advising on restoration and traditions of construction were issued by the Architectural Press and Batsford. A planner like Thomas Sharp, imbued with the organic principles of Patrick Geddes, was seriously concerned with the implications of uncontrolled development and published his Design in Town and Village with contributions by William Holford and Frederick Gibbard in 1953. Tied to this move to the vernacular, tied to this move to the re-understanding of the non-architectural heritage, were two articles published in the 50s by Jim Sterling. His articles on regionalism are explicit responses to the Architectural Review. In the first article on Garche to Zhao, no, that's fine, I'll sing along. His first article, Garche to Zhao, was an interrogation of the modern principles behind Garche and the apparently regional principles behind Zhao. The principles that overturned a vision of Le Corbusier as an academic modernist, and looking at his work through the war and then just after the war, we can see a very strong return in Le Corbusier to the craft traditions in which he had been imbued and built, of course, in Chaux-de-Fonds as an architectural student and just after graduation from the art school there. We see in Zhao a perfect example, as Sterling wrote, of North African regionalism transported to Paris and built, no less, by African workers. So Jim's problem there was not the turn to regionalism, was the displacement of one regionalism into another region. And of course he concluded the essay by saying, well, the Garche is actually much more a regional product of elite intellectual Paris than the transportation of North African regionalism into the suburbs of Paris. That meant a sense of crisis. This is the article. Actually, this is a little bit of an aside. In his drawing of Garche, he is completely and implicitly criticizing Colin Rowe's drawing of Garche. Colin Rowe took Garche as a facade moving back in vertical slices, and Sterling takes Garche as a series of horizontal slices, much more based on the domino principle in which Garche was produced than Colin Rowe had recognized. That's an aside. But then in his notebook, he produces a series of these all photographs by Sterling himself as he begins to compare the two structures, Garche and Zhao. It's very important to go back to the original publications, those of you who are interested in history, and even those of you who are interested in architecture as a kind of historical phenomenon, because you'll find, for example, in the Mathematics of the Ideal Villa or in the republication of these articles in Sterling's republications, you won't find the very carefully calculated sets of comparisons in photographs that Sterling was actually setting up. And it's very, very important, I think, to begin to read these sets of photographs and comparisons as a strong dialectic. And of course, this is precisely the year in which he returned and Ham Common shifted in design from being a proto-modernist pavilion behind a Georgian house to a post-Zhao set of constructions. And then Ronchon, the second article in Jim's Intellectual Formation, where he begins to talk about the crisis of rationalism. What do we do with something produced by an architect we've always thought of as rationalist, as functionalist, as machine aesthetic, with an expressionist operation like Ronchon? And he concludes that we have to take it as an object on a hill, much like we would take a castle or a farmhouse or a barn on a hill. And in the Ronchon article, he does exactly what Banham has advised in 1955 in his publication of Hunt Stanton. He moves around the building as almost like a cinematographic photographer. Another subject for a PhD actually would be the shift in points of view and photographic status in relationship to the understanding and appreciation of buildings in different periods, from the invention of the movie to the reconstruction of photography in series as a kind of prototypical movie, all the way through to, of course, an appreciation of object and installation art, as Rosalind Krauss talks about, the going around the sculptural object in the round. So this is another aside. But anyway, that's Jim's going around Ronchon. Around and round and round. And concluding with a series of articles that are in response to the Architectural Review's special issue on the functional tradition, which is a special issue which illustrated in beautiful photographs by Eric de Marais all the great vernacular industrial buildings of England, the docks of Liverpool, for example, which Sterling himself is going to photograph much later, the docks of Liverpool, factories, oast houses, farmhouses, rural vernaculars, and so on. This encouraged Sterling to begin to imagine what a modern vernacular would be. And interestingly enough, in that modern vernacular, he posts a photograph that he took of a farmhouse that's in the centerfold there, and a design that for Wooten House that he designed almost as a farmhouse in the landscape. Various projects, the Churchill College, compared to castles, courtyards, and other vernaculars, and the Churchill College composition itself, which in a sense attempted to construct a new vernacular for what he called the flat landscape of Cambridgeshire, where the berm that was formed on which the student housing emulated the Roman berms of various earthworks in the region, and the houses themselves within were castellated and organized just like vernacular buildings. So there's a sense here that we're trying to develop a modern formal language out of the vernacular that is being studied. At the same time, the Smithsons are also studying the vernacular, very seriously studying the relationships of buildings to the landscape in terms of the picturesque, Poussinesque tradition, beginning to contrast the natural forms of network architecture to the geometrical forms of the Corbusian architecture, and beginning to investigate and to understand the local architecture of farms in different areas of the country. And in their project, which is well worth studying, another PhD subject perhaps, Burroughs Farm, which was developed in a series of plates for the CIM Congress number 10, which was dedicated to the village and rural architecture, they began to develop their own principles of a rural architecture and published it in 1957 in the Architectural Review. And ways of organizing the development of the traditional English village, larger scale developments and smaller scale developments, and of course the way of reorganizing in a brilliantly ironic way the suburban house of the mass suburbanization of the 50s, if you like, taking the Mickey out of the facade of the generic house, but inside giving a perfectly modern little brutalist essay in house architecture. I show you, and then finally, Jim Sterling's own contribution to that Congress, a series of very, very elegantly drawn axonometric plates of how village construction could be self-built, self-built party walls, self-built roofs, and so on, which would then, in different patterns, according to a very simple typological exercise, restore the fabric of a village that was being desecrated by modern construction. And the whole idea here of a new village architecture also being explored by people like John Volcker at the same time. The real irritation between, let's call it that, between Sterling and the Smithsons was evinced by Sterling having submitted these plates to the CIM Congress, not being invited by the Smithsons to the CIM Congress. Thank you. So tomorrow we'll pick up from there and move towards the present in a series of post holes again, trying to fill in the blanks of certain things that have been ignored in general surveys of contemporary architecture. Certainly those projects, notably by Nicolas Chauffeur and Yanis Zanakis, which I would call proto or pre parametric. Yeah, I'll take questions, yeah.
Questions?
Yes.
My name's Peter Phippin, and I happen to have graduated in 55, I think,
yeah.
So I was there in a sense.
Yeah.
Derek Sugden of Arabs, who commissioned the Smithsons to design that, he first of all rejected the first design, I think, by Alison Smithson. Am I telling you something you know? Or?
Yes, but please.
Yeah, okay. Which was based on a castle, because they were very influenced at the time by Khan, who'd been over here and admired Kenilworth Castle. And Derek Sugden threw it out. He didn't like it at all. And Peter Smithson said something like, you know, look, we've got to Alison, look, we've got something like a good client here. We'd better do something good. So he took it over and designed this house, which I'm not so sure I agree with your point about it being ironic. I think it was quite a serious reinterpretation of the typical suburban house. But the point I wanted to make was the interior is a bit more complex than you suggested, because the Smithsons said, I remember Peter Smithson writing, you know, our model was a Dutch traditional interior, hence the checkered floor out of Vermeer and De Hoogh and so on. So, you know, all I just want to say is really, it's incredibly complicated, these influences. And
the minute you go into any of these things, one of my problems in writing a survey, which is where I am right now, is to what extent are those kinds of where those details are absolutely.
search, writing on the house, the history of the house, the archive of the house, one could find that complexity. Now, the only question I have is, I think, well, the question about irony, I knew Peter too, and I always thought that there was a really serious effort behind everything, but always there was a little shadow of épaté, les autres, of let's tongue-in-cheek a little bit, and somehow the straight-laced version of this house on the outside continued being disoriented by a kind of Lucian, well, the windows will be where they are because that's what the inside is about. I think it can be both and.
Right.
And I have to say, when she came to Cambridge to criticize my work as a student, she was not ironic.
I'm sorry to hog this machine, but once you've got it, design in town and city, that was interesting. I mean, it emphasizes how much the government was involved, because it was published by the Stationery Office,
yeah.
And you could go and buy a whole range of books about architecture, yeah, and construction. But you mentioned it was Thomas Sharp's book. I rather ignored that bit and went on to the Freddie Gibbert piece, which,
yeah,
was the start of his book called Town Design, City Design, I can't remember which.
Yeah.
Anyway, the figure, of course, behind that was Camilla Sita and the Design of Cities According to Artistic Principles. And that book and the arrangement of blocks in courtyards and so on, I mean, ruled English housing design for a good few years, the early parts of the new towns and so on.
And Sharp's own article there, where he gives the example of the of St. Mark's Square as a prototypical square, was taken very literally by Sterling and Alan Poynton when they did their Sheffield scheme, which was precisely organized according to the geometry of St. Mark's Square.
Mm.
I'm a little curious that this transformation of paradigms that you're talking about, is it more context responsive or it is to do with the individuals related to it? If I'm making a point here, is if I see India in this context, in this period itself, and Corbusier in India, I'm not able to relate the similar process completely. But yes, there are notions of the of what we're talking about. So do you think it was more how it happened here versus how it happened there, or it was to do with people like Corbusier or Sterling themselves who brought it on paper?
Absolutely, I think if one was to do the same study in other contexts and in other moments, one would find different individuals, different politics, different governmental agencies, and different and certainly different cultures of environmental renovation or environmental construction. Absolutely, yes. No, this is not. There will be in this book, which is within a series which is unfortunately entitled The History of European Architecture, there will be certain contrast among different nations, different groups, but it is true that increasingly after World War II, European architecture and the Euro-American axis became gradually a point of reference for world architecture.
to what you just said, it seems to me though kind of like one would wait till the third, end of the third lecture to see what's happened. Mm-hmm. One of the consequences of what you're unfolding is that it really doubly displaces the normal kind of survey narrative. I mean, one for the reasons you gave yesterday, but secondly, one of the consequences of those narratives is that, you know, as you move through the century, you know, that's what you're always where you've got to. Mm. You know, you've done what you've done, and then you're turning to what's coming in the future, which couldn't be further from the truth than the way you present the materials. On the one hand, at any one moment, the discussions are much more kind of local and specific, while at the same time, the topics of reference are much broader and wider. Therefore, you know, you're not presenting a story which is all about arguments about what modernism really is, you know, which in some sense you might kind of retrospectively expect it to be. And I think that's kind of incredibly important. The way in which it just reshapes, well, first of all, it exposes what goes on in normal narratives.
Right. An example can be, I was interviewed for Fulcrum this morning, and the interviewer asked me whether or not I felt that now there was a possibility for a new modernism, right? Well, that question opens up that particular huge can of worms. What is modern? What do you mean by modern? I said, I'm interested in the fact that at certain moments, certain individuals, certain discourses, certain institutions defined words like modernism for their own purposes in particular ways, right? But that does not mean that one can therefore talk about a modernism, a new modernism, in anything but terms that would be utterly polemical and be totally to do with my version of what I wanted architecture to be. And so, as a historian, that's not right.
It must be very strange, I mean, for the question that came earlier, someone kind of wandering back into the AA later would find, you know, when in the morning they'd sort of, it feels as though they'd find the discussions so completely different and, you know, a different world from what they were. And then the afternoon, you begin to notice certain similarities, but everything had sort of changed its language slightly.
But you still feel back in school.
Yes. Question. Sorry, there was one?
If there's another question, yes.
I'd like to return to Venturi, because we happened to be discussing about complexity and contradiction in architecture yesterday here with Pier Vittorio Aureli. And
very, very special understanding.
Yeah. So one point he really emphasized was the fact that in complexity and contradiction we don't have any kind of project for the city. We have just architecture understood formally in its specificity and just, you know, the artifact of the building. And your presentation today makes me think whether one could see Venturi having a kind of view to the city that is mostly related with townscape and the picturesque, and then developing this other kind of Scott Brown version of Venturi, which has to do with learning from Las Vegas populism and stuff. So if what is your take on that?
Well, I think there are two things. Of a particular vision of architectural history. think of it as facade, its complexity is, in a sense, a small landscape. And it becomes, something which, when inserted into the city, will be a sign like the signs of Las Vegas. Right? I think this is a question that is never quite, that I think that Venturi's got around learning for Las Vegas is an extraordinary interesting moment in a career that was dedicated up to that point to the individual building. So it's understanding the city, but seeing the buildings as a small city, which is the Alberti operation, right? At the point of learning from Las Vegas, the point of going to Las Vegas in 19, whatever it was, in the early 70s with the Yale group, and as a being, is in a fabulous new French PhD on that precisely, on that visit, and the records of the visit. She's gone to the archives. I can't quite remember her name at the moment, but it's a very, very good PhD. And it's, in a sense, it defines the complexity of their reaction in a way which is in a sense, completely gainsaid by the simplicity of a reaction to it. If you read Frampton against that, or others against the Las Vegas parameter with a horror of consumerism and all that, that's the most first degree reaction against what is actually a very complex book and a very complex photographic and reaction to an environment that was an estrangement for the students and the two teachers at that point. So I think, again, taking your point of the complexity behind the things that we read very quickly and take in our history courses, again, that has to be a moment of reflection and work.
To the seminar. So we'll meet back at 3:00.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.